Hello, everyone, and welcome to the Microsoft Security Update Summary, where I will present a short recap of what was released today, January 14th, 2025. My name is Josh Daniel, and I'm a risk manager in the customer service and support organization here at Microsoft. I'm going to start this video with an overview of the release, and then I'll dive into a few of the vulnerabilities. Please note that the details of the vulnerabilities I am covering in this video may change, and the authoritative location for information will always be the online content in the security update guide. Before I dig into today's release, I like to compare it to the previous 12 months to see how it stacks up. With that, we have 159 newly disclosed vulnerabilities in today's release, and that's quite a bit higher than our average over the past 13 months of just under 92 per month. Of those 159 newly disclosed vulnerabilities, 58 of those fall into the remote code execution impact. This is the type of impact that typically provides the most risk. It would allow a threat actor to install software and other high-level activities. And our average over the past 13 months is just under 36, so a little bit elevated there. Next, we'll move into scoring, where Microsoft uses a common vulnerability scoring system, or CVSS. This is a scale between 0 and 10, where 10 represents the most risk. This is a scale that allows different vendors to be able to compare and contrast vulnerabilities, whether it's a hardware vulnerability, a software vulnerability, a firmware vulnerability, or even between different vendors. The same number represents the same level of risk across all those products. This month, the highest scored vulnerability is 9.8 on that scale of 10. We've been averaging right around 9.6. And this is the eighth month in a row where we have had 9.8 or above. Next, we'll look at the average CVSS score across all 159 vulnerabilities, which comes in at 7.25, which is about a quarter point lower than our average over the past 13 months. Now, I commonly say in this video that the CVSS score is a starting point. It allows, as I mentioned, vendors to be able to compare and contrast different vulnerabilities on a common scale. And so it's a great starting point, but it doesn't include everything when we talk about risk. It doesn't include the impact of a vulnerability, whether it's remote code execution, elevation of privilege, spoofing, or so on. It doesn't include things like the severity, which is critical or important, moderate or low. And it also doesn't include things such as whether or not it is publicly disclosed or not. This month, we have 5 vulnerabilities that are publicly disclosed, which is more than double of our average over the past 13 months of 1.9. The CVSS score also does not include things such as whether or not the vulnerability is known to be exploited at the time of release. This month, we have 3 vulnerabilities that fall into that category, which is a little bit higher than our average of 2 per month. Next, I'll move into the overview. So now we're just looking at this month's release, at the January release. And as we look at the Windows products, we've been averaging, depending on the operating system, in the mid-40s for most of them. And then with Server 2025, which is brand new and only has a few months of history, that one's averaging closer to 70 vulnerabilities per month. Either way, more than what we've been seeing on average in the Windows products. As we move up the chart, we get into a handful of vulnerabilities in Office and SharePoint. We also have a few vulnerabilities in developer tools, including .NET, .NET Framework, as well as Visual Studio, and then Power Apps to round out the vulnerabilities in this release. First vulnerability that I will talk to from today's release is CVE-2025-21333. This is an important elevation of privilege vulnerability in the Hyper-V anti-kernel integration component. This one was privately disclosed to Microsoft, but exploitation has been detected. This has a CVSS base score of 7.8 on that scale of 10. The attack vector is local, the attack complexity is low, the privileges required is low, and user interaction here is none. I'll point out here, there's actually 3 vulnerabilities that are very similar to each other that all hit the same component, all have the same score. They're all important elevation privilege, all exploitation detected. they're very similar to each other, but it's three distinct vulnerabilities. So when I talked about three vulnerabilities that are known to be exploited, it's this one, 21333, as well as 21334 and 21335. There are no documented mitigations or workarounds for this vulnerability. And as far as the affected software, it's Windows 10, Windows 11 on the desktop side, as well as Server 22 and 2025 on the server side. The next vulnerability that I will talk to is CVE-2025-21298. This is a critical remote code execution vulnerability, privately disclosed with no known exploits out in the wild. This has a base CVSS score of 9.8 on that scale of 10. So this hits our high water mark for the release. The attack vector is over the network. The attack complexity is low. Privileges required is none. And user interaction here is also none. We do have a published mitigation here, which is to configure Outlook to read all standard mail in plain text format, which is probably not an easy lift for a lot of companies, but that is a mitigation there if you're not able to deploy the update across the endpoints. Now, I realize that the mitigation is in Outlook, but the vulnerability resides in the object linking and embedding component of Windows. So to fully protect your endpoints, you'll need to install the Windows update, but the mitigation here is an Outlook. As far as the affected software, it's all versions of Windows that are in mainstream support, whether that's Server 2016, 2019, 2022, or Server 2025, or Windows 10 and 11 on the desktop side. Next, I'll talk to CVE-2025-21307. This is a critical remote code execution vulnerability in the reliable multicast transport driver, otherwise RMCast. This one was privately disclosed with no known exploits out in the wild. This has a CVSS base score of 9.8 on that scale of 10. Again, hitting that high watermark. The attack vectors over the network. The attack complexity is low. No privileges are required and no user interaction is required. We do have a mitigation here, and that's essentially that there has to be a program that is listening on that PGM port. So it's not directly related to whether PGM is installed or not, but it has to be installed and enabled, and there has to be a program listening on that port. There are no documented workarounds for this. As far as the affected software, it's Windows 10 and 11 on desktop, as well as Server 2016, 2019, 2022, and 2025 on the server side. And the last vulnerability that I'll talk to today is CVE-2025-21311. This is a critical elevation of privilege vulnerability, privately disclosed with no known exploits out in the wild. This has that base score of 9.8, again, that high watermark in the release. The attack vectors over the network. The attack complexity is low. No privileges are required, and user interaction here is none. We do have a mitigation here, and that's essentially to set the NTLM compatibility level to its maximum value. This will prevent the usage of the older NTLM V1 while still allowing NTLM V2. There are no documented workarounds as far as the affected software. It's Windows 11, Server 2025, and Server 2022. If you are a Microsoft Premier or Unified Support customer, and you would like to attend the full briefing call where we cover more content and are available to answer questions, you can either work with your customer success account manager to sign you up, or you can sign yourself up in Services Hub. All right, I want to thank you for joining me today. Let me talk about some vulnerabilities, and I will talk to you all next month. Thank you.